Hello, my name is Metin Tolan. I am professor for physics at TU Dortmund University, Technische Universität Dortmund, and my major field of research is the investigation of soft matter materials such as proteins or polymers with synchrotron radiation. It's a tremendously interesting field, but I'm not going to talk about this field today. I'm going to talk about one of my hobbies, James Bond. The title of the talk is Shaken, Not Stirred, James Bond in the Spotlight of Physics. And you can see the outline of the talk here. I will give you first a short introduction into the topic James Bond, just for those of you who don't know who James Bond is. Then we will start with the physics. We will come to a chase of James Bond, which we will discuss in detail. We will discuss in very great detail one of the watches of James Bond. You know that there is always a small gimmick of Q incorporated in one of his watches. We will see this. We will look at a mirror image in the fourth part of the talk. And at the end of the talk, I will explain you the title of the talk, Shaken, Not Stirred. Why is James Bond drinking his vodka martinis in this way? Of course, there is a physics reason for this, and I will give you this reason at the end of the talk. Okay, let us start. James Bond was also affected by the coronavirus pandemic because on March 5th, it was announced that the 25th Bond movie was postponed from April 2nd to November 12th. I will come back to this later. But you could see at this moment, well, they already investigated 50 million euros in advertisement and in the James Bond song. And when this big movie is postponed, you could foresee that something big is happening in the world. And as we all know, this was the coronavirus pandemic, which has hurt the world much. Okay. But let's start with the topic James Bond. James Bond was invented by Ian Fleming, a British novel writer who died much too early. He wrote in the year 1953 the book Casino Royale. It was a book about a spy who was acting between the two superpowers of that time, Soviet Union and the United States. And this spy became very popular. This book became very popular. So Ian Fleming wrote more books, and all these books about the spy became very popular. And it is clear that very popular books are sooner or later going to the cinemas. And this was, of course, also the case with those books and this spy. And the spy had the name James Bond, and we will now take a look at all six actors who played James Bond so far, when they introduce themselves in the very special James Bond manner.
Bond. James Bond.
My name is Bond. James Bond.
My name is Bond. James Bond.
Who are you?
Bond, James Bond.
Thank you, mister.
The name's Bond. James Bond.
The name's Bond. James Bond.
And you probably all know who James Bond is. James Bond is an ornithologist from Philadelphia. This is really the true story. Ian Fleming had a large bookshelf. He had many books, and one of these books which he possesses was the book from the ornithologist James Bond, Birds of the West Indies. And he really took the name of the ornithologist James Bond and gave it to his spy of the books. This is really the true story. And only if you know this story, you can fully understand the following small clip from the 20th Bond movie, Die Another Day.
What about you?
Oh, I'm just here for the birds.
Hmm.
ornithologist.
You have seen this? Now you are able to understand this in its full meaning. Of course, this is a reference to the origin of the name James Bond, which you can hear in the 20s Bond movie. Okay, the profile of James Bond was defined by Ian Fleming in his books, and I think the most striking property of James Bond is his 00 number. What this means is best explained by his boss.
If you carry a 00 number, it means you're licensed to kill, not get killed.
Licensed to kill, not get killed, as M is saying. This is, of course, clear. When you take a look at the passport of James Bond, there is one very interesting thing. When you look where he is born, place of birth, he is born in Wattenscheid. James Bond is born in Wattenscheid. Wattenscheid is in Germany, part of a Ruhr town, Bochum. And obviously, Bond is born in the German Ruhrgebiet. So this is very surprising, but this is true. Because there exists an official biography of James Bond, which is interesting in its own. There is an official biography of James Bond. And in this official biography, it is mentioned that James Bond was born November 11th, 1920 in Wattenscheid. So he is 100 years old. He is in pretty good shape for 100 years. In Wattenscheid, as the son of a Scottish engineer and a Swiss mountaineer. And this Scottish engineer, he had to do something in the German Ruhrgebiet, in the Ruhr area, and this is the reason why James Bond was born in Wattenscheid in Germany. Okay, James Bond has weapons, he has strengths, he has weaknesses, alcohol, for instance, we will see this, and also women, of course. I will show you now a small clip from the Bond movie Goldfinger. You must bear in mind, this movie is from the year 1964. 1964. Please bear this in mind. Nowadays, you could never show such a clip in a movie.
Just here.
No, a little lower, darling.
I thought I'd find you in good hands.
Felix. Felix, how are you? Dink, meet Felix Leiter.
Hello.
Felix, say hello to Dink.
Hi, Dink.
Dink, say goodbye to Felix. Man talk.
1964. This was 1964. You have to bear this in mind. Okay. He speaks different languages. We now know why he is speaking German. He has some characteristics. What is important also is that James Bond has a weight, or better said, a mass of 76 kilograms and a size of 1.83 meters. This was defined by Ian Fleming. And the actors are always very close to these numbers. For instance, Daniel Craig has a weight of 78 kilograms and a size of 1.82 meters. I think this is within the margin of error, I would say. And apropos Daniel Craig, he will again play James Bond in the 25th movie, No Time to Die. This was the very first teaser of this movie, where it was announced that the movie will appear in April 2020. Okay, so now I think we are well prepared for the physics of James Bond. You all now know who we are talking about, and we will start with one chase. James Bond is after Scaramanga in the movie The Man with the Golden Gun from the year 1974. It was the second movie with Roger Moore as James Bond, and Scaramanga is the villain. Scaramanga is with his car on one side of a river, and James Bond is with his car on the other side of the river. And James Bond want to go after Scaramanga, and so he had to cross the river, but there is no bridge, or we will see the bridge is broken. How James Bond is solving this problem, you will see this in a minute.
Here's bridges 2 miles back.
What the hell are you doing now, boy?
The bridge is that way! You're not thinking that.
I sure am, boy.
Ever heard of Evel Knievel? Neither have I, actually.
Wow, this looks very interesting, and we are now trying to explain what we have seen. We try to understand this from the physics point of view. Okay, so what did we see? We see an AMC Hornet car. This is an AMC Hornet car here. The car is going to the ramp. Obviously, this was a bridge before, but the bridge is broken. Only the two ramps are still there. The car is going to the ramp, and since the ramp is a little bit tilted, the car is spinning around the longitudinal axis and lands on the other side of the river. And now we want to understand this. First, we have to define an interesting question. Very often in physics, you must think about an interesting question. What could be an interesting question here? Well, of course, physicists are good in calculating flight paths. For instance, you can calculate the flight path of the car. The blue line is the exact flight path, which you can calculate, including the rotation. And the red line is the flight path without a rotation. So you can see the rotation does not affect the flight path much. It is not important for the flight path. It is important when you want to land on the tires, but it is not important for the flight path. And also the flight path itself is not really interesting. You can calculate it and that's it. I can tell you what a much more interesting question is. An interesting question is as follows. Suppose that this works, that this really works. Then the distance between the two ramps is fixed. The angle of the ramp is fixed. The tilting angle is fixed. Everything which you can see here is fixed. If this really works, then it only depends on the speed with which you are driving on this first ramp. This is the only variable in the game. This means, in other words, if you know the speed, if I'm telling you the speed for the car, then you can do this stunt with your car. Everybody can do the stunt. You can take your car and do the stunt when you know the speed with which you have to go on the ramp, provided you trust me, and I think, and I hope you trust me. So when I give you the correct speed, then you can do the stunt with your car. This is an interesting question. Is this really true? Can you do this by your own? Well, first we have to clarify, was this really a real stunt?
Are you the chap who designed or did the car stunt in the Houston Astrodome?
Yes, this was obviously a real stunt. It was done by stuntmen in the beginning of the 1970s in the last century. So we are talking about something which is real. This makes it even more interesting, the question, can you do this also with your car? And the answer to this question is no, because we have to talk a little bit more about rotations. Rotations are only stable around certain axes. So this means if a body is rotating about a symmetric axis, a symmetry axis, such as A, B, or C, when you have such a body, these are axes with a symmetric mass distribution around the axis. If a body is rotating around these three, around one of these three axes, then the rotation is stable. Just for the experts, I also know that for one of these axes, this is not true, but this is just not important now. So we can just bear in mind, if a rotation is supposed to be stable, the mass distribution of the body, of the rotating body must be as symmetric as possible. This axis along the diagonal is not a symmetry axis of the body. And this means a rotation around this axis is not stable. I can show this to you in the experiment because I have this body here. And if this body is spinning around the middle of this yellow area, this is one of the stable axes, one of the symmetry axes, then it rotates completely stable in the air. Yeah, the axis is completely stable. If I rotate this body around the diagonal here of this red area, then you can see that the axis is staggering in the air. You must look very fast. You can see that the rotation axis is not stable anymore. I get the body back in a completely different position. I can show this to you with a much smarter experiment. The much smarter experiment can be done with a gyroscope. With a gyroscope. This gyroscope is now our car. And this is the longitudinal axis of our car. This is the rotation axis of the gyroscope. So this would be our car. Here is the motor. Here's the trunk. And now we can put four heavy masses around the rotation axis of the gyroscope. You can see this here. This is the front side. We have here two heavy masses on the front side each, and two heavy masses on the back side, so that they are put around the rotation axis in a way that you have a heavy mass here on the back side, one on the back side, and on the front side. All four masses are equally distributed around the rotation axis. And I have this experiment here with the four heavy masses. You can see two here and two there. And now we will rotate this gyroscope. I will do this here. And of course, it is nothing really surprising that the gyroscope is rotating. When I hit it a little bit, you see it is staggering a little bit, but it is still stable. The rotation is stable. I will now repeat this experiment, but I will change a little bit the mass distribution. While I'm doing this, I show you what the makers of the stunt were saying, why the stunt was operating, why the stunt was working.
On a computer.
The computer was used by the National Highway Safety Bureau in the investigation and reconstruction of single vehicle automobile accidents worldwide. The firm that happened to do that was a company in Buffalo, division of Cornell University. An ingenious engineer there by the name of Raymond McHenry visualized that we could do a complete football spiral type with a full-size automobile.
The exercise is quite complicated because the car has to be perfectly balanced. The steering wheel is in the middle.
The car had been cut in half, widened about 2 inches. Everything was then centralized and balanced.
So they were explaining why this stunt was working. And they gave two explanations for this. Explanation number one was, you need a genius engineer to calculate this. Well, I can just tell you that when I'm giving the physics lecture for engineers at TU Dortmund University, we calculate completely this stunt in the first semester. This means that we are only educating in Dortmund brilliant engineers, as you may have known. No, the real answer is it is not that complicated. People who are a little bit familiar with physics, they can calculate it. It is not a big deal. The second thing what they were saying, this was obviously the important thing. They needed a car with a completely symmetric mass distribution around the longitudinal axis. This means they cut this car, this AMC Hornet car, in the middle. They put the steering wheel in the middle. The driver was in the middle. The motor was exactly placed in the middle. The trunk was exactly placed in the middle. The roof was taken away and replaced by a lighter one, so that around the longitudinal axis, the mass distribution of the car becomes as symmetric as possible. Why did they do this? I show this to you now when we repeat the experiment. We now repeat the experiment with, it is almost the same, but the only difference is that we now have on the front side the two heavy masses placed here, and at the back side at the same position, so that around the rotation axis we have here and here heavy masses and there nothing. So it's now placed in an asymmetric manner. And we will now repeat the experiment, and this is really the only difference. The only difference is that the mass distribution is slightly different. Okay, you have to concentrate, you have to compare this with the experiment which we did a couple of minutes ago. So, again, of course, a gyroscope is spinning, this is not a big deal. And when I hit it a little bit, you see, I think it is now moving, well, how can you describe this movement? It is now moving more complicated, I would say. It is moving now in a totally chaotic way. This means a body with an asymmetric mass distribution, which is rotating, moves in a totally chaotic way. And this is the reason why you needed a car with a symmetric mass distribution in order to perform this stunt. When you have such a car, then of course it's not that difficult. You have to take this angle of the ramps, you have to take the length of the ramps, you have to measure the tilting angle of the ramp. Obviously, Bond is doing this because he is waiting a couple of seconds so that he could guess this tilting angle. And when you do this, then you have to do a little bit mathematics. And the outcome is you have to enter the ramp with a speed of 64 kilometers per hour plus minus 3. This is the margin of error. This could be done. So you have... This stunt is working with a specially prepared car. So when you do, when you would like to do this with your car, you have to do some welding work in your garage before. You need such a prepared car. Then you have to go to this point with 64 kilometers per hour, plus minus 3. And when you are at this point at the ramp, what do you have to do then? Nothing. Nothing. The rest is done by physics. You are also not allowed to do anything. You have to sit there in the middle of the car. In fact, the stuntman was lying in the middle of the car. He was fixed by belts so that he can't move. He could just a little bit move with his arms the steering wheel. And then the stunt was working in the first try. So you see, there is a lot of physics involved in these things. And of course, when you really want to do this, you have to do all the calculation first. Okay, let's come to the next topic. The next topic is about the watches of James Bond. In the watches of James Bond, always a small gimmick of Q is included. We will now discuss one of these watches in great detail. It is from the movie Live and Let Die. It is from the year 1973, and it was the first movie with Roger Moore as James Bond. Let's take a look at the watch which he has in this movie.
I've got your ticket to New York. Q has repaired your wristwatch and some background material on San Monique.
Thank you, Moneypenny.
I'm sure the overburdened British taxpayer would be fascinated to know how the Special Ordnance Section disperses its funds. In future, Commander, allow me to suggest a perfectly adequate watchmaker just down the street. Good God.
You see, by pulling out this button, sir, it turns the watch into a hyper-intensified magnetic field, powerful enough to even deflect the path of a bullet. At long range, or so Q claims.
I feel very tempted to test that theory right now. If you don't mind, Commander, my spoon.
Oh, sorry, sir.
Thank you.
Yeah, you have seen the watch, and I think it's pretty simple to explain how this watch works. He is playing around with the watch, obviously. Then he switches the watch on. Then this watch is able to attract the spoon, and we assume now that the spoon is made out of iron or steel. And then he switches the watch off, and he can take the spoon off. So it is clear what this watch is. This watch is an electromagnet. This is clear. He even says this. He is talking about magnetic fields. So this is not an interesting question again, because it is clear that this is an electromagnet. However, physics is a quantitative science. Quantitative means you can calculate numbers. If you want to become quantitatively, then you have to ask a quantitative question. And the quantitative question is as follows. We think that this watch is a very expensive Rolex watch. It is so expensive that we don't want to open this in the first try. We don't want to open this watch. We have here the watch and here the spoon. And we can guess that the distance between the watch and the spoon is approximately 1 meter. Approximately 1 meter. And then we put one coil of wire, of copper wire, on the back side of the watch. One coil of copper wire. And we ask ourselves, how large must the current be which is flowing through the wire in order to create a magnetic field large enough to attract a spoon at a distance of 1 meter? This is a quantitative question. You may know that current is producing always a magnetic field. So, when we ask this question, we have to calculate the following. We have to calculate all the forces which act on the spoon. There is, of course, force number one is the gravitation, its weight. And the spoon is moving to the clock when the magnetic field, which is created by the current in the coil, in the copper coil, when the magnetic field, when the attraction force by the magnetic field is larger than the weight of the spoon, then the spoon is moving towards the clock. And we now can ask ourselves, how large must the current be that the magnetic field at a distance of 1 meter is large enough to attract the spoon to overcome the weight of the spoon? You can calculate this. I did the calculation, and the result is the current must be 4 billion amperes, 4 billion amps. Well, this is a pretty large current, I would say. We don't discuss now the question what batteries you need for this. Obviously, Q has invented some super batteries. But what you also know is if a current is flowing through a wire, then the wire is going to heat up. And this means this watch will heat up during operation. And this is what you can calculate. You can calculate that this watch will heat up to several billion degrees. Well, it's not important if you say centigrade or Kelvin. It's almost the same. So to several billion degrees, the watch will heat up. This means he starts his watch, and then he gets vaporized. In other words, it cannot work in this way. So we have to do something else. Well, we can improve the watch significantly if we decide to open the watch and take everything out from this Rolex watch. We take everything out, and in a first improvement, we put in a wire coil of 100 copper turns. A wire coil of 100 copper turns, and this wire coil is put around an iron core. And this increases the magnetic attraction force enormously. probably you know this, when you have built an electromagnet by your own, you take copper and you, for instance, put this copper around a nail or something like this. So this is in general how you build an electromagnet. This improves dramatically the situation. When we now calculate the current which is needed to attract the force with this watch at a distance of 1 meter, it turns out that we only need 8,000 amperes, which is still a pretty large current. It's a very large current. And of course, the watch will heat up again. It will heat up to several thousands of degrees centigrade. So it also did not work, because when he started his watch, then the watch will become liquid, and it will, of course, not work. So it also doesn't work. So what is the reason why this watch, who at the first glimpse looks like very easily working, when you really try to do it quantitatively, is not really working? There are two reasons for this. Reason number one is this watch is too small. If the watch is larger, then it would work. We did an experiment at a junkyard in Dortmund. I will show you this experiment. I'm sorry, this video is in German, but I think you can see what is going on.
Aber wie reagiert auf einen Löffel von 10 Gramm? 3 Meter. 2 Meter. 1 Meter. Erst jetzt gibt der Löffel dem Riesenmagneten nach und fliegt durch die Luft.
You can see this was really working. We have been there at a Saturday on this at this junkyard, and it was really great. I mean, I was also allowed to do some experiments with this magnet, and it was really dreams of my childhood came true. It was really great fun to do this, but it is of course very inconvenient to wear this magnet on your hand. So the problem here is this magnet has 50 times the diameter of the watch of James Bond. The magnetic attraction force at a distance of 1 meter is not only 50 times larger, but 50 to the fourth power, more than 6 million times larger. So diameter of the watch is important. This is the reason why we tried to construct the best watch possible. We took 1,800 very thin coils of wire, which we put around a core of an amorphous metal with a very much magnetic permeability. This is so thin that it is unlikely that you can really do this, but we said, well, Q is probably possible to do this. The watch is supposed to have a diameter of 4 centimeters, that much. It should not be larger, because otherwise people do not believe that this is a real watch. And we made it a little bit thicker, 7.5 millimeters thick. And so we put all this copper coils in. And when we did this, it turned out that we need a current of 5 amps in order to attract the spoon at a distance of 1 meter. 5 amps is still not such a small current. We also would not discuss which batteries you need for this. And this watch during operation will still heat up. It will heat up to 250 degrees Celsius. Well, we would say this is a watch for James Bond. He has to withstand this. He is not a normal person. He can withstand 250 centigrades. Well, why is this watch so unbelievably to realize? Why it is so difficult to realize this watch, to build this watch? And now we come to reason number two. Reason number two is that the magnetic attraction force decreases extremely strongly with the distance. At 10 times the distance, the magnetic attraction force is not just 1/10 of the original value, but 1/10 millionth. 1/10 millionth. So this means if you have a spoon at a distance of 1 centimeter, you may attract the spoon with an electromagnet, no problem. But when you go to 10 centimeters distance, you can only attract a 1/10 millionth of the spoon, which is the weight of the size of a grain of sugar. And when you go to 1 meter distance, you can only attract a 1/10 millionth of a grain of sugar, which is essentially nothing. And this is the reason why you have to use so much current in order to bring a little bit magnetic field at 1 meter distance. A magnetic field is decreasing extremely rapidly with distance. This is the reason why this watch is not really working with normal parameters. Therefore, the following would already be possible with a second best watch. Look at this.
Such a delicate touch.
Sheer magnetism, Danny.
Well, he is saying because I'm a magnetism man. This is not true. I have to correct James Bond. He should have said the small distance makes this possible. You can calculate that you need a current of 100 milliamps and a potential of 2 volts in order to achieve this, and this is the performance of a normal battery. We also did the experiment. We opened this at a skirt of a girl with such an electromagnet, which we built with these parameters, and it worked. And it worked. So we did the experiment also. James Bond is after the villain, Mr. Big, and Mr. Big caught James Bond, and he placed James Bond on a very, very small island. And it became a little bit uncomfortable of this island, as you can see. Well, was he really running over crocodiles? Was he running over crocodiles? Is this true? Well, you have to bear in mind, the movie is from the year 1973. This was 20 years before Jurassic Park. So obviously, somebody must have run over crocodiles. And that's true. A stuntman was really, five times a stuntman was running over crocodiles, over the backs of crocodiles, as you can see.
Defying stunt.
as he's about to jump, the crocodiles all do this because they're saying, here comes that guy again. I mean, they'd seen the act twice, and so they're waiting for him to jump again.
Finally, on the afternoon of December the 31st, Ross Kananga defies death for a fifth time.
The good thing on the old of the old James Bond movies is that everything which you can really see there must have been done in reality, because the animation techniques were not that developed. You can ask yourself, why didn't those crocodiles hurt him? The reason is very simple. They were really fed up. They were completely fed up. They were really not hungry. They only wanted to play. This was very clear. Okay, but let us ask how this is possible when you want to run over crocodiles. Of course, there is a gravitation force. The gravitational force pulls you to the center of the Earth, so you would sink in without the crocodiles. We need another force to compensate the gravitation. Well, we have, in fact, two forces. One is the recoil force. There is a recoil force. It's the same force which propels a rocket. What recoil do you have here? A recoil means that you are throwing a mass in this direction, and the recoil gives you a movement in the other direction. So what recoil do you have here? The recoil is when you go with your foot into the water, then the water is also put in one direction, and the recoil puts you in the other one. But this is here the smaller force. The larger force is the friction force. This is a force which you experience when you take, for instance, your hand and move your hand through the water. And this friction force depends on the speed with which you move your hand through the water. And so this is the reason why it depends on the speed whether James Bond can run over the crocodiles or he's sinking into the water. And when you calculate this, so that you calculate the speed so that the friction force compensates the gravitation, then the result is James Bond has to move with at least 22 kilometers per hour over the crocodiles, which he did, I would say. So this is reasonable. The friction force also depends on the area with which you move through the water. And obviously, the area of the foot is this small. And the crocodiles, the reason it works with the crocodiles is because they increase the area of the foot by approximately a factor of 10. You can ask yourself, well, if you don't have the crocodiles, how fast must you run that you can run over water, that you can run over water? And you can calculate this, and the result is 100 kilometers per hour. With 100 kilometers per hour, you could run over water. Well, you have to bear in mind the fastest man on Earth, Usain Bolt. He achieved at his world record of the year 2009 in Berlin of the 100-meter dash. He achieved as top speed 45 kilometers per hour. 45. So it's a way to 100 kilometers per hour. For a human, it's not possible to run with 100 kilometers per hour. So this is the reason why we cannot run over water. But there is a second possibility what you could do if you want to run over water. You can decrease your weight. And there is one animal on Earth who can, or which can, run over water. It is called the Jesus Christ lizard.
With the pond in the way, most lizards wouldn't stand a chance. But this is no ordinary lizard. For years, cinematographers tried to capture its steps with varying success. Witnessed at normal speeds, their fleet-footed water dance leaves nothing but questions in its wake.
So you can see, running over water is in principle possible. And well, this lizard has something in common with James Bond. The lizard is also only running over water in very dangerous situations. Otherwise, of course, the lizard is also just swimming. Okay, let's come to the last topic. We will talk about a mirror image in a movie. And the movie we are talking about is the movie Goldfinger, probably the most popular James Bond movie ever, from the year 1964. And we will take a look at the first minute of this movie.
Oh!
Forgive me.
Why do you always wear that thing?
I have a slight inferiority complex. Where was I? Oh, yes.
Okay, a very brutal clip, I must admit, but we are watching it for totally scientific reasons. I will now going to explain you that if we analyze this image of the attacker in the eye of the lady, if we analyze this, we will figure out one property of the attacker and one property of the lady. Let's start with the attacker. The attacker is here behind this thing, and then you can see he has a stick in his right hand. He has a stick in his right hand. I think this is clearly visible. And the mirror image has the stick also in the right hand. This is a problem. You may know that a mirror exchanges left and right. So this is a problem. It should look like this. He should have the stick in his left hand. But this is not the case. He has a stick in his right hand. We have to explain this first. And in order to explain this, I will offer you two explanations. Explanation number one is, the movie is from the year 1964. What you could do in the year 1964, you could produce such an image by superimposing two images. You do it in this way with a projector. You project the image of an eye to a wall, for instance. And then with another projector, you project a movie of somebody who is working towards the eye. Then you superimpose these two images. And with a camera, you take the simultaneous image so that you have somebody who is moving towards an eye in an eye. So this was possible in the year 1964. Nowadays, of course, it would be very simple to correct for this. You would take these two clips, you would fit them with a video cutting program together. You were thinking, well, this is a mirror image. You can push a button, left, right, exchange, and that's it. But not in the year 1964. Not in the year 1964. This is explanation number one. Explanation number two is more simple. Explanation number two goes as follows. Between this and this image, the villain takes the stick in the other hand. And of course, explanation number two must be true. So this means that the villain is particularly dangerous because it makes no difference for him to hit somebody with his left or with his right hand. He has equally strength in both hands. He is neither a left-hander nor a right-hander. He is a both-hander. And so these people are extremely dangerous. And we figured out by looking carefully at the mirror image that the villain in this case is a very dangerous man. But we can also figure out something about the lady. If we take this as an illustration of an object on a spherical mirror, This is a spherical mirror. When we have an object, a particular object of size g, the object is at a distance to the mirror g, small g, then what we now would like to do is, we would like to calculate the size of the mirror object. This is our plan. And the size of the mirror object depends on the focal length of the mirror, and this is given by r, which is the radius of curvature of this sphere. Very simple. And now what you have to do is, you have to take the laws of geometrical optics in order to calculate this. So our object which we have is, of course, the villain. The villain has a size of 1.8 meter. How can we know this? Well, the villain was approximately of the same size compared with James Bond. And James Bond was 1.83 meters, so 1.8 meters is a very good guess. Then he is 2 meters away from the lady. This is also a guess which we can make. Of course, the radius of curvature of the eye of somebody is approximately 9 millimeters. It's a rough number, but it doesn't matter if this would be 8 or 10. So 9 meters is a good average for the lady, I would say. And our plan is now to calculate the size of the image. This is what we want to calculate. And if you do this, if you calculate it according to the laws of geometrical optics, the result is the size of the image is supposed to be 4 millimeters. 4 millimeters. 4 millimeters. This is what we expect for the size of the object, the size of the mirror image. Okay, we were thinking about this, and our students were saying, well, let us do an experiment. And this is the reason why you see here the eye of Katarina Voronyuk. Katarina Voronyuk, at that time, she was a student a teacher student. She is now a school teacher, a high school teacher at a Dortmund gymnasium, a high school teacher for mathematics and physics. So this is the eye of Katarina Voronyuk. And she is attacked, of course, just for scientific reasons, by Frank Hommes, also a student at that time. And Frank Hommes has a size of 1.8 meters, and he is 2 meters away, exactly the same as in the movie. And when we now measure the size of the image, then we get 4 millimeters for the size of the image. Well, our theoretical calculation was 4 millimeters. We do the experiment, and we have also 4 millimeters. Wow, theory and experiment fit together. I'm always saying physics is the only science where the projections are coming true, I would say. So, but this is not the end of the story, because this may work for Mr. Hommes and Mrs. Voronyuk. But in the movie, the image is much larger. Half of the size of the man fills completely the eye of the lady. In the movie, the size of the mirror image is 2.8 centimeters. So something still is wrong. Maybe the size of the attacker is wrong, because we guessed it. And this could be true. This could be true. And we can recalculate the size of the attacker. And everything is working if the attacker has a size of 12.5 meters. 12.5 meters. Well, this is, of course, a little bit too large. If you are a theoretician, for instance, then you would say, then you are satisfied with the solution. But an experimental physicist like me is saying, well, the size of the attacker was not the size of a four-story building. So something else must be wrong. Maybe the distance of the attacker is wrong. The 2 meters was also just a guess. And you can again see our hero students. This is the eye of Mrs. Voronyuk. And you see half of the body of Mr. Hommes' mirror image. So the image has a size of 2.8 centimeters. So it's working. It's possible. However, Mr. Hommes is at a distance of 30 centimeters from the eye of Mrs. Voroniuk. This can also not be the case. It is too narrow, because between Mr. Hommes and Mrs. Voroniuk, you must place James Bond. And if this were the case, then, of course, James Bond did not have to see the attacker. He would recognize his breeze in his neck. So this could also not be possible. The only thing which can be possible is that the curvature of the eye of the lady is somehow special. And everything fits together if this curvature is 6.3 centimeters. 6.3 centimeters. What does it mean? This means the curvature of a normal human of the eye is 9 millimeters. It's the curvature of a 2-cent coin. The curvature of the lady, of the eye of the lady, is 6.3 centimeters. It's the curvature of her eye, and I would also guess not of only one eye, but also of the second eye. Why should the second eye have developed much different? The curvature of the eyes of the lady is 7 times weaker than the curvature of a normal human. So with this eye, you cannot put a contact lens in this. This would not compensate for this weak curvature. We figured out with this analysis that this lady cannot see anything. She's blind. She may have recognized James Bond because of his voice, or she smelled him or whatever, but she clearly could not have seen him. So we figured out one very important property of the lady.
Shocking.
Oh.
Positively shocking.
Well, he does not mean, of course, the lady. He is complaining about the situation where they are all in. Okay, let's come to the last point, to the end. I'm now going to explain you why is James Bond ordering always his vodka martinis shaken, not stirred. But let's first take a look that he is really doing it.
Can I do something for you, Mr. Bond?
Just a drink. A martini, shaken, not stirred.
Yes, sir.
The lady will have a Bacardi on the rocks.
For the gentleman, vodka martini, shaken, not stirred.
Touché.
Miss Kennedy, would you get me a medium dry vodka martini?
What a dry...
Shaken, not stirred.
Cut.
What words do you live by?
The trick is to quit while you're still ahead.
Now, that's one trick I've never learned. Perhaps you'll show me how it's done. Vodka martini, shaken, not stirred. And for you?
The same.
Yeah, and Daniel Craig also ordered in the 24th movie, Spectre, his first vodka martini, shaken, not stirred. So let's take a look why he's doing it. And when you address a scientific question, you first always are looking into the literature. And when you do this, you can find out that 20 years ago, Canadian scientists already figured out why James Bond is doing it. Their conclusion is, 007's profound state of health may be due to, at least in part, to compliant bartenders. They figured obviously out that he is doing it because it is very healthy. Well, if you have such a theory, you have to find proofs for the theory. And this is impossible. There is no scene in any movie, there is no line in any book of Ian Fleming that James Bond wants to eat or drink very healthy. Not at all. You will not find a single line. So this health theory cannot be proven. And this is the reason why I developed my own theory. And I have to say, well, this is a theory and it has to do something with physics. But if this is really the reason for James Bond, for a vodka martini, you have to judge by yourself. Of course, as a physicist, I took a closer look to the liquid. And the liquid, the vodka martini, consists of two types of molecules. You have so-called aromatic ring-shaped molecules. They are very large, these molecules, and they are responsible for the taste of the liquid. And then you have alcohol, ethanol, a very small and compact molecule. Well, this is, of course, responsible for the kick. So a vodka martini is a mixture of two types of molecules, the large one responsible for the taste, the smaller ones responsible for the kick. And now we can ask ourselves what happens if we shake such an ensemble of large and small particles. You may know this when you ask stuff like this. All the big things are then at the beginning, at the top. This is called, the effect which happens here is called the Brazel hazelnut effect. It goes like this. If you have large and heavy green balls here at the bottom of this beaker, and if you have black light balls on top of them, and if you shake this ensemble long enough, then for some magic reason, the heavy big balls are going to the top and the light black balls are going to the bottom. This is called the Brazel hazelnut effect. It is a very difficult effect, difficult to explain. It's an effect of granular matter. This is the topic of physics. You can explain it with this animation. If you shake here, then you sometimes get a hole of the size of the smaller balls. This means that a small ball can go from top to the bottom. But you never create a hole which is as large as the bigger balls. And this means they can never go to the bottom. But if only the blue balls can go, small balls can go to the bottom, then the bigger balls have no other chance to go to the top. Well, this is theory. I will show you this in an experiment. We will mix our a model vodka martini. This is our beaker, and I will put in now big molecules. These are the big red balls here. And I will put the alcohol on top. These are the small molecules. These are small white balls, as you can see. And now you see, well, we can even do a little bit more. Now you see the big balls are at the bottom and the white balls are above. When I now shake this, you can see that all the big balls are going to the top. It's clearly, you can clearly see it. And it happens really very quickly. Very quickly, all the big balls are on the top. Okay, this is the Brazel hazelnut effect. And now you probably know already what the reason is. In the stirred vodka martini, all the big and the small particles are distributed equally. In the shaked vodka martini, the big molecules, which are responsible for the taste, are all concentrated on the top of the liquid. And now we just have to think about for whom we are doing it. We are doing it for James Bond. Obviously, James Bond knows when he is going to order his vodka martini that he will not have the time to drink the full vodka martini. He could at best drink one mouthful of this liquid. And this mouthful should be very tasty. So he wants to optimize the taste of the liquid. My theory is that he is interested in the taste, that he is interested in the taste of the liquid. And for this theory, I have a proof.
Too many free radicals, that's your problem.
Free radicals, sir?
Yeah, they're toxins that destroy the body and the brain, caused by eating too much red meat and white bread and too many dry martinis.
Then I shall cut out the white bread, sir.
Then I shall cut out the white bread, sir. So I think this is the proof that he is really interested in the taste of what he is eating and drinking. Okay, this was my final physics explanation. Let me just explain a few things further on. When I said we in this talk, I mean my theory colleague, Joachim Stolze, and 41 students who took a seminar 13 years ago on the physics of James Bond. And the result of this seminar was a book which we wrote together, The Physics of James Bond. This is a book in German, the German version, Geschüttelt, nicht gerührt, James Bond im Visier der Physik. So we produced this book. This is a new version of the book, also with many Daniel Craig stunts in this book. And this book appeared recently also in an English version, as you can see here. Shaken, Not Stirred, James Bond in the Spotlight of Physics. So this version appeared recently. And if you are neither capable to read German nor to read English, there is also a Portuguese version in the meantime of this book, The Physics, La Física de James Bond. It's a Portuguese version. So I'm advertising this book always because when you buy this book, you do not support poor professors in Dortmund. When you buy this book, all the money from this book goes to our students. We support with this money our students with stipends and with other support. And we have a lot of very good students at TU Dortmund University. And so when you buy this book, the money of this book goes directly to our students. This is what I wanted to mention. And this is the reason why I'm doing so much advertising for the book. I am thankful to Frank Pries. He helped me in preparing this talk. Here you see some references which I used. I'm also thankful to the Lernsender of TU Dortmund University. We have an own TV channel. They produced this talk here with different cameras so that you can enjoy it in a very special manner. I am really thankful for this. Thank you very much to all people who are involved in the production of this video. Okay. This is the announcement of the James Bond movie, and it is already again postponed to the 2nd of April 2021. Well, if one is doing this on and on and on, one has to be careful. Probably one also has to change the photo in the advertisement of James Bond, and it may look like this at the end. Okay, hopefully not. Hopefully we can enjoy the movie on April 2nd, 2021. And at the end, I will come to a very small James Bond statistics. We have so far 24 Bond movies and we are waiting to the 25th. Bond ordered 28 vodka martinis and visited 73 different, 37 different countries. This is what he did so far in all 24 movies. Bond was 33 times told that he will die. There are 60 Bond girls so far. You can make different classes out of them. 16 times women whispered, "Oh, James," in the movies so far. And the next number we have really carefully analyzed. We have carefully analyzed each James Bond movie. We have each scene carefully discussed and analyzed, and you may know that physicists are known for their accurate data acquisition, and we did this. So I can absolutely surely say that James Bond, in all 24 movies, in all 24 movies, all movies together, James Bond had exactly 84 times sex on what? Of that, 26 times in, at, under, or on the water, 19 times in hotel rooms, 2 times in an apartment at London, 14 times at her, 1 times at somebody else's place, 3 times in a train, 2 times in a shed, 2 times in the woods, 2 times in a nomadic tent, 2 times in a hospital, 2 times in an airplane, 2 times in a water plane, 1 time in a submarine, 1 time in a car, and 1 time in a motorized iceberg, 1 time under the shower, and in the movie Moonraker, 1 time in a space shuttle, and this is this I'm going to show you at the end.
Colonel Scott reports picking up 2 survivors from the space station, a tall man and a short blonde woman.
Right. Okay. Dr. Goodhead reported their position 20 minutes ago. They're just coming into range of our tracking ship in the Pacific Ocean. We should have audio visual within a few minutes from the remote onboard TV monitors.
Houston calling Dr. Goodhead. Houston calling. Confirm your position.
As this is the first joint venture between our two countries, I'm having it patched directly to the White House and Buckingham Palace.
Well, I'm sure Her Majesty will be fascinated.
We have audiovisual.
Ah, at last.
My God, what's Bond doing?
I think he's attempting re-entry, sir.
James.
I think it may be time to go home.
Take me around the world one more time.
Why not?
Thank you very much for your attention. Thank you very much for watching. And I am happy to take your questions.